Leadership versus rulership. Popular American novelist, late Frank Herbert, once said, and I quote, "Good governance never depends upon laws, but upon the personal qualities of those who govern. The machinery of government is always subordinate to the will of those who administer that machinery. Hence, the most important element of government, therefore, is the method of choosing leaders." And I dare to ask this question: do we have leaders in Africa, or are we just ruled by rulers? For me, leadership is summarily the capacity and the will to rally men and women to a common purpose and the character which inspires confidence. In view of this definition, I like to disagree with the popular saying that Africa is backward because of bad leadership. Because you have to first of all have leaders before you experience good or bad leadership. Suffice it to say that Africa's problem is that she has been plagued by rulership for too long. I like to say that a ruler is someone who behaves like a mathematical ruler. A ruler is rigid and not flexible or adjustable. And the moment you try to bend it, it breaks. A ruler dictates the pace and does not want too many changes. Otherwise, they are bound to break due to lack of emotional intelligence. On the other hand, a leader is someone who behaves like the lid of a pot. Whether you flip the lid upside down or put it in the way it's supposed to be, it will still get the job done. That being said, a leader is a person who is flexible and allows creativity in his or her workplace or constituency and has high emotional intelligence to back that up. In another perspective, rulers are those who rule. To rule is to control, to direct, to impose rules, to dominate, and to exercise ultimate power and authority over an area or its people. In contrast, leaders are those who lead. To lead is to guide, to direct on a course, to serve, to take responsibility, to represent, and to be on the forefront of positive change. Not the kind of change APC brought to Nigeria anyways. Leaders have willing followers, while rulers have dominated subjects. Rulers impose their authority. Leaders, on the other hand, can earn their authority as a matter of expertise, emotional intelligence, and people-orientedness. Essentially speaking, good leadership is not about power, benefits, or exercising authority. It's about guiding people to a common purpose in a way that represents common interest. It's about the people and not about the leader or the power. And that is why in sane continents and countries, leaders resign when they lose favor with the people who elected them to represent their interests. In Africa, however, resignation does not exist in our political lexicon. Most democratically elected presidents in Africa think like monarchs. They would rather die than relinquish power before their tenure elapses or before they are violently ousted from power. Now, it's possible that Africans in general and Nigerians in particular may have found normalcy in rulership. But like Louis Blackwick once said, and I quote, "A day may come when all hope is lost, when the oceans run red with our blood and our darkest hour is upon us. And when that day comes, the red day of reckoning, we turn, my dears, not to our rulers in good times, but to our leaders in bad times."
Yeah, thanks for that. I'll just quickly chip in here. And I'll say that rulers and leaders are non-identical from one another. So you have rulers, people who tend to rule. A ruler can't be, you know, simply a smaller controller. A ruler normally rules over the individuals against their will, just to tell them what to do. People tend to do it because of the power that emanates from this individual. There's no charisma, there's no personality attached to it. It's just the power, pure power. And they use power of authority. And the very purpose of a ruler is to rule people's lives. On the contrary, I'll say leaders are individuals who lead, and they tend to lead by example. They attract followers using their strength of ideas, whereas rulers are quite poor in the idea management side of things. Leaders don't demand allegiance. They use the power of attraction, like I said. Rulers tend to be arrogant, but leaders are modest and always stay open to suggestions. So a leader can have a suggestion which might seem in his or her head something that is very smart, but haven't considered other people's opinions, is liable to change it, might not be immediately, but, you know, open to suggestions, and doesn't believe he's the smartest or she's the smartest person in the room. I can't say rulers are leaders, but not, I can say that rulers are leaders, but not all front runners are rulers.
Right. So I'd like to come from another perspective. Now, I tend to be a non-conformist. Yeah. Right? But the thing about leadership is not soft. It's not flaccid. Yeah. It's not indecisive. Leadership does not pander to emotions.
Yeah.
And I think that's when we come at this issue of separating leadership and rulership,
yeah,
that we come from that perspective of emotion or sentiment. Yeah. Oh, a leader knows how to appeal to followers. A ruler is firm. The truth is, you can't separate leadership from rulership. Because in assuming authority, yeah, in assuming a forefront position over other human beings, there are times you have to put your foot down. You have to assert your voice. You have to assert your opinion. You have to assert your authority. So I think, in a nutshell, it's about semantics and personal feelings, sentiments. When we try to separate leadership from rulership and say one is good or the other is bad, I tell you the truth, it's worse to have a leader at the helm that seems to have no direction or has not the power to insist and, you know, move people into a particular direction for the greater good. I don't want to, mention names, but it's a lot easier to have a firm leader, someone who, based on the descriptions, you call a ruler, who is not really in tune with the needs of his people, but moving us in the direction of progress.
Okay, I think a good leader should be able to combine firmness with people-orientedness.
Absolutely.
Right? It's like the difference between the difference between rulership and leadership in this context is like the difference between democracy and autocracy. In a democracy, while the leader is looking forward to protect the interests of the people who have elected him, he also understands that there are times when, as a leader, you have to be firm and stick to your decisions. Unlike in the other system, where what people want is not really important to the leader. Mm. The leader has absolute power. Okay? Mm-hmm. And the idea behind this is, in Nigeria, we have elected people who seem to be doing what they want to do and not necessarily what the masses want them to do.
You know, for me, I'm going to come from a governance perspective. Mm. First, I don't agree we have leaders in Nigeria. I'm of that perspective. I'll tilt to Kemak's perspective. So what we have in Nigeria is that we have people in political position and not a government. And if you look at the trace of everything, last leaders I think Africa had were pre-colonial era. We cannot say the colonialism structure did not do a number on our thought process.
Right. So I look at
the early leaders in Africa as Shaka Zulu, who wasn't even a softie.
Right.
Yeah.
But, you know, leadership.
But
leadership
they commanded
comes with
that
direction.
Influence. Mm-hmm. And that,
if there's anything you're going to pick from leadership for me, that I would look at, leadership comes with charting a course.
Mm. Exactly.
Every leader had a course. You can pick leaders from different times. Alexander the Great, he wanted to expand his nation. You know, Napoleon.
There was a clear vision.
Queen Aminah of Zaria took her kingdom from Zaria, which is in northern Nigeria, extending it up to Ghana. She died somewhere in Ghana.
Right.
She was killed in a war somewhere in Ghana. And that was leadership. Yeah. So, but when the colonials came in, and we cannot divorce them from this, they taught us how to follow the gunpowder. Because then you'll be like, okay, you have your gods. We have one true God. And if you argue with them, guns.
Yeah.
So we've gone to that level. It's gotten so bad that I'll give an example with the National Assembly. National Assembly summons the president on security matters. And the Attorney General of the Federation comes out and says, you can't summon the president. Yes, in the Constitution, it's not written anywhere. But mark you, in the act that creates, also in the same constitution that creates the National Assembly, it states that the National Assembly can summon any Nigerian at any point in time, as long as the presidents in Nigeria. So we don't even understand these things.
Yeah.
I think we're just used to the gun approach.
Exactly. So we have a lot of people in politics who are not in governance.
Yes. Yes.
And that's a
like
big problem.
In political position,
but not in governance. So the problem is Professor Pierre Lumumba of he's a Kenyan legal luminary. He once made a statement some years ago. I was listening to him. He said that the problem with Africans is that Africans have a lot of affinity for people without ideas, right? During elections, you see people who have powerful ideas about how they want to transform the nation or the continent, the charts they want to take the nation to. But you discover Africans going for people who have political and economic clout, choosing them over people who have ideas. And that is why, at the end of the day, we end up electing politicians and not leaders, because people can't give what they don't have.
Absolutely.
Right? If you don't have an idea, you don't have something you want to achieve, you don't have a clear vision. Once you get to that power, you discover that at the end of the day, you just end up exploring the power and not necessarily doing anything with governance.
There's something key I always think about, especially in Nigeria, maybe because I've run for office before. I kind of understand this funny part about Nigerians. Nigeria's problem is that it's not that they don't know which politician is good or not.
Mm.
They do. They clearly do. They always do.
Yeah.
The problem is that the entire Nigeria sees Nigeria as a buffet table, and everybody's waiting for his turn at the buffet.
Yeah.
So what happens is, no, I won't distort Mr. A while he's in power, because me, I want to chop my own. This guy wants to stop everything.
Does that appeal to the electorate or just the
It appeals to the electorate, because I'll give you an example. You enter power today, I can tell you, your causes are going to come from the village to Abuja. Where's our contract? Where's our this? Where's our official car? Where's this? Where's that? And we don't want it to spoil, because if someone now comes in and says, okay, I'm going to stop official cars, I'm going to stop, all people in governance are going to be any minimum wage.
Right, it's like, is it my own turn? Speaking about what, I remember once coming down from a hotel, I was coming out of a hotel, and then I saw a car drive in, and then everyone was like, and then I looked at the man at the back of the car, he looked like one of the governors in the South.
Yeah.
And I was like, oh, is this not this governor? And as he came down from the car, I was like, Your Excellency. But I said, the resemblance is not really there. Mm. Guess what? He was a younger brother to the governor. And I almost lost my mind. Like, I was living with rage.
He was accepting
all the accolades and responding to the Your Excellency calls. And I said to my assistant with me, like, what kind of a joke is this?
Oh, no, that's interesting.
You know, even for that, that's even a little close, the brother. Well, we have people that are barbers to His Excellency in governor, and they have business cards.
I know,
and
right?
It's
really a sad thing. It's time to take some of your comments on the issues discussed here. Ohale Odehora says, reforming the Nigerian constitution is important. Define a new vision for our country. Pull out all the reactionaries wherever the base, education, healthcare, energy, transport, and put the interests beyond the demand of the citizens. Phantom 2K10 says, great build, great minds, and great platform. Now follow us on our social media platforms on Facebook at PlusTV Africa, hashtag TheAdvocateNG, or on Twitter and Instagram at PlusTV Africa, hashtag TheAdvocateNG. To catch up with previous broadcasts, go to plustvafrica.com/theadvocateng. It's time for our music lessons with Yemi, but only after this break.